seeing this failure in the examination and what can be done? Okay, let's start with Yomi this morning. EduPlanner does a lot of work in looking at the data, following the numbers as well, particularly for spending on issues concerning education. But looking at the trend from the early 2000s thereabouts in the WASC examination, what are we seeing and why are we seeing it?
One of those things we need to look at here is there's been massive failure from time, because if we're actually going to talk about failure, then you say pass is 70%. That's what you can call excellent for any student. But when you're having below 40%, then that's failure. But if you look at the trend, for example, from 2009 now, 29.9% actually, 25.99% failed, okay, actually passed in 2009, 21.94% in 2010. 2011, you had 38.81%.
39% in 2012?
Yes. And now in 2013, you had 29% also.
It dropped again?
That passed. So it's actually been something that has been happening over time. So you are saying 70%, which is failing, 25%, which is passing. And this is just something that has been happening that has been taken as a norm. But now in 2017, one thing we should look at is WAEC has different examinations.
Mm-hmm.
They have the May, June WAEC. You have the
November, December,
mm-hmm. which is the GCE. Now, they just introduced this January, February diet.
Schedule. Mm.
So it's defeatist for them eventually, because now they are being judged on different data sets for themselves. If you look at GCE, for example, it's actually for maybe people who are out of school, who are no longer in the secondary school system, exactly. but are still trying to write WAEC while working.
Mm.
Unlike the May, June, which is actually for students in the school system yes. itself. And when you look at the May, June, for example, the figures are actually better, unlike the November, December, or the January, February that's now been introduced. And the whole outcry now is from the January, February diet,
mm-hmm.
which actually 17.13% passed, which is actually a total failure on the part of WAEC. And one begs the question, we know the challenges that WAEC has faced over the years, which is examination malpractice. But what have they been doing as an organization to actually curb this? But instead of doing that now, you're not having them creating more exams. At the first instance, do we need even the November, December? Because it boils down back to an organization that is actually assessing students on certificate examination to carry out examination time and time again, and students are failing. But they are not doing enough to actually curb this, which is what JAMB has done better. In that regard, they've introduced CCTV into their examination
halls. Mm.
They've been able to make sure that it's online. They've been able to make sure that now they monitor which officials monitor their different examination centers across the country, which is actually helping them. But unlike WAEC now, you are seeing them creating another diet, another examination in another time, and that is not going down well for the education system.
They are making more money. They are making more money. I mean, if we like it or not.
And more students, that's the truth.
And most students are failing.
Most students are failing, which is actually defeatist on the long run. And you can see one of those, the repercussion of this is this. You see students lose more confidence. They lose confidence in writing these exams eventually. And what it means is examination malpractice continue to increase. But one thing we need to realize is this. 10 years ago, if you look at examination malpractice, it's not as rife as this.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm trying to print a scenario of the teachers who are actually providing these answers now. 10 years ago, they probably might still be a secondary school. Now, these same teachers cheated. So you are having a system that is now providing fake answers. So even for
issues, because malpractice,
they never got punished.
Yeah, not malpractice in one sense is for students to be able to pass the exams.
Yes, exactly.
And then the flip side of it is that now there is heavy, examination malpractice, exactly. and students are failing.
Yes. So because the answers that are now being provided
are wrong.
So it's now disturbing the whole activity eventually.
Oh my.
It's defeating your activity eventually. So you see, because one of those things that WAEC needs to work on is like there's an examination malpractice syndicate.
Within the organization.
Within the organization. You see, exams are being kept, they are being made sure they are under high security. But 24 hours before that paper, these papers leak. And there are actually persons who are already on ground to actually make sure that we are providing answer for these questions and we are distributing it. Now, you are in the age of social media.
But wouldn't that, but let's follow up on that, but wouldn't that then mean that if the answers are leaking and many people are getting access to the answers, you should actually find a unnecessarily high success or pass rate?
Exactly. That's why I painted a scenario of teachers 10 years ago cheated. They were under examination malpractice. So you can practically say they didn't write that exams on their own. Do you understand? And so they are out
really
now.
Don't have a solution.
Exactly. They really don't have that solution that they can actually give to the students of today. So they end up providing wrong answers to today's candidates who cannot who don't even have time to actually check through.
To be sure
if the answers are right.
Since it's coming from an examiner.
Yeah.
From an examiner. Just
together. You know?
So you're in a center and the answers are being provided. You don't have any time as a student, whether you are brilliant or not, to even check it. And if you are not copying the answers now, and you know there are special centers now.
Mm-hmm.
So when you do special center and the answer is being provided to you, then the onus is for you to write it down without even checking. Maybe afterwards you leave the exam while you start checking. The only part maybe a student might be able to check one or two things is in the theory aspect. But in the OBJ, which is 60 questions,
You just shade on.
And at the end of the day, you get your right answers.
Let me bring Alex into this. Even though it is poor consolation, Ghana too has also the poor performance of Nigerians in the exams is not only peculiar to Nigeria. Ghana has also been affected. In 2014, only 28% of Ghanaian candidates actually passed the exam. And in 2015, that number then went to 25%. And then there are also issues of students getting better results in our own national examinations, like NECO, for example, and the fact that the certification system places a lot of emphasis on English language and mathematics. Is it time for us to revisit the West African Examination Council, to revisit the whole exam and whatever it provides to Nigerian students, period?
Well, thank you. I don't think it's necessary to revisit it because WAEC is there to set a standard for our academic performance,
but
for our
students.
But
we're failing. Majority of them are failing.
Now, it's to ask ourselves, why are we failing?
Mm-hmm.
Are we preparing enough for the WAEC in the first place? My WAEC was not too long ago, and I remember it was... you had some things that you had to do. WAEC is an SS3 exam, but it starts in SS1. So how are the teaching methods, the schools? If you start teaching them in SS1, are you teaching them consistently to prepare them for WAEC?
Mm.
Let me give you an instance. If you have a good physics teacher in SS1, you'll probably be an A student in SS1. But if you get a very bad physics teacher, maybe a core member who just wants to pass time in SS2 second term, you're going to have a problem in your WAEC in physics.
Mm.
So that the
consistency.
Yes,
okay.
The consistency in teaching, and then the capacity of the teachers themselves.
The quality
of the teachers. Mm. We saw what happened in Kaduna and in Edo State. Mm. So if those are the persons who are teaching, then you're going to put the blame on WAEC to an extent, but I think much of the blame lies with the teachers and the school. The facilities in the schools, the libraries, the laboratories. WAEC starts with practicals, but in most schools, the first practicals students do is probably 1 month before WAEC.
The main exam.
That's the first time they touch a test tube or a conical flask or anything. I had the experience anyway.
Especially for schools that are substandard.
Yes.
They don't have an acute.
Even schools that you may expect are not substandard. Federal government colleges, for instance.
Mm.
So they don't start these things on time. You don't start doing those practicals on time. And those things factor in your A or in your C that you get in your exams.
Or your D or E.
Or your D or your F. So I don't think we need to say we don't need WAEC anymore. because it actually helps us set a standard. So if you have someone who has, despite the failures, we still have people get 7 A's.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes. And when someone has 7 A's, you know this kid is going somewhere. So if we say because we've been failing, we don't want to admit the mistakes we've made, the deficits in capacity, in infrastructure, then we are setting ourselves back.
You raise a really interesting point about the issue of capacity. Of course, many of us know that Nigeria has not hit the United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization, UNESCO's recommendation for how much of our budget, national budget, should go into education. Yes. The recommendation is at least 26% of the annual budget should go into rehabilitation of public institutions of education as well. But we know that paying well, hiring qualified teachers who have masters, and it's not all masters that are equal, I know that as well, but at least being able to identify that quality pay, quality teachers will get us better results. It just seems to be A plus B equals C, but that equation never equals in Nigeria.
It's never considered. It's one of those things when you're trying to solve, maybe you have a problem and you know force equals mass times acceleration, but
yeah. You say
F is equal to MA. Don't worry.
I'm so far. Ask me about anything else. I'm so far out of that.
But they don't consider that as a formula that could work in the first place. I mean, why couldn't you invest? You hear communications management trainee, graduate man. Mm-hmm. Why don't you have something that serious with teaching? When Bill Gates says invest in human capital,
capacity, yeah,
or human capacity, teachers are very important because you can't give what you don't have. And like Isaac Newton would say that if I have seen far, it's because I stood on the shoulders of giants. Mm-hmm. So if we, many of us, our teachers were our heroes. They were persons who inspired us. So if we don't have good teachers, if we don't invest in quality recruitment and in quality remuneration, we are going to have that. We are going to continue having that problem. Like Yomi said, if 10 years ago, a student was a professional in malpractice, if you become a teacher, you just aid and abet. That's
you become a master.
You become a master.
I need this professional.
Yeah. You know, and then we have this, I'm very sure you will be familiar with this particular slogan. If you get an A, I got an A in physics, but Waye gave me F9 in chemistry.
When you pass, you claim it. But when you fail, I gave it to you.
And that's a valuable point that we need to go to now. So let's look at that, because when you talk about the failure of the examination with WAEC, it's usually split into 3.5. You have teachers, which we've just talked about now. You have parents. Yeah. Then people talk about students themselves. Mm-hmm. Then some will go to the government. And and some have said that students themselves, if somebody is doing this examination and getting 7 A's, what is wrong with the 70% of you that are failing? Because some would say that now children are now more exposed, telephones and movies and all those things. Internet are taking away their daily time for them to focus. But if somebody is getting 7 A's, the 70% of you that are failing, what's wrong with you? That's a question. That's one. Then we've talked about, we'll get to your answer all that. Then we talked about the schools and the teachers part of it. But also society. And listen to this. Now, the head of the National Office for WAEC, Charles Egwurudu, last year when he was speaking to Guardian, blamed society, among other factors, for the poor performance of students in the regional exam. He said that the values of our society are so distorted. The Nigerian child is a victim of his environment because children live what they see. People are blaming WAEC, but WAEC is not supposed to doctor marks to please the society. Yomi, what do you think?
Yes, I think he's very, very right about setting a standard. And that's what WAEC actually comes in to do, to set a standard for our society. Can you imagine if it was a Nigerian Certificate Examination Council, we and we alone, we won't be able to set our standards for ourselves. And I actually shy away from saying that kids are the one I blame here. They are far from it, because they are still in their growth process. They are still growing. They are still trying to form their lives together. At least you have 16-year-olds, 15-year-olds still in secondary school. Not yet.
Many 18. Of them are writing exams.
Yes. So it boils down back to the society. It boils down back from the government. It's a cascading that effect from the government to the schools to the parents, because if we don't allow something, it won't happen at the first instance, and that is where we all come in before we even get to the students at all. And I was telling my colleague before we came in here that you see, all these things, the students don't know anything about it. Whether you have a bad physics teacher or you have a good physics teacher, it's until he or she gets to the classroom before he or she discovers that. Mm-hmm. So we need to actually set our priorities right. And like what the Senate did last month, yes, a very good call. But are we just going to talk about it and sweep it aside, take it to one side of the room and move on, just like we have continued to do? You know, since last year, for example, when the Kaduna teacher debacle happened, the presidency called an emergency meeting with the Federal Minister of Education. But what did we get out of it? Then it came out in November and said that by April ending, we'll be having a state of emergency. I believe a state of emergency is something you discover and you declare immediately.
Not
you, you don't put a time frame to it and say, by the end of April, we are going to declare a state of emergency. So we as a society, we need to actually discover, what does education do for us? Mm. It's been subscribed that the areas, the countries that are well educated are more peaceful. So it's a palliative for security also. You look at the Northeast, for example, you look at so much insecurity, and when you look at the level of education in that region of Nigeria, you see that it's near to nothing. And these are some of these things that we need to begin to see, that education helps us grow us in our economy. It helps us to grow economically. It helps us to grow politically. It helps us to grow as a people. Hmm. So if we can see education from that goal, beyond the old WAEC, beyond the old schools, we need to make a concerted effort towards making our education work in Nigeria. Hmm. And when you look at it, because success in exams and examination malpractice is a correlation.
Hmm.
So if you have more examination malpractice, that means there will be low performance that year. But if you have...
That if it panned out negatively, negative, if the answers are correct, then you have like 80-90%
success. If you can actually reduce examination malpractice in a year, for example, then you have the chances of achieving better success is high.
I disagree.
No, I disagree. When you reduce examination malpractice,
yes,
if we can reduce examination malpractice in a year, then the chances of having better results in that year are higher.
That is on the basis that the students have been well taught.
Yes, yes.
That exactly. They have been well taught.
Yes.
But we have our big teachers. We have teachers who probably became, most of the teachers we have in school, I have a friend who looked for a job for a very long time. He's in the teaching, field now. And that's because he couldn't get a job of his dream. So the people who go to the university to read education, people who went to National College of Education, they are not even found in the corridor. All of them probably are doing something else. People who are not trained teachers are the ones we actually have, trying to impact knowledge in our schools.
You see, Madam Obi Ezekwesili said something. She said, more of the challenges facing the education sector is not even funding. It's actually a structural problem.
Yes.
It's a dysfunction. You know, why I said that is the fact that you said the persons who are going to the NCEs might be better. But the truth is, who do we even admit into NCEs at the first instance? Do you let's put that in perspective?
Yeah, but there's
good. Do we want the graduates of Federal Colleges of Education to actually teach? Let's put that as a thought.
I mean, why not? What are they trained to do, really?
It's
an institution of education.
It's an institute of education.
Yeah.
But at the same time, one other factor you look at is when you look at you're doing your job, for example, you are trying to get admission. It's until you don't get admission into the university
that you go to
polytechnics, and you can say, okay, let me try College of Education.
But I have a younger sister who is a graduate of the National College of Education Technical in Akoka.
Okay.
And she further proceeded to UNILAC to do an education course.
Education course,
exactly.
Yeah.
She's a teacher. She's a vice principal now.
Mm.
One of the model colleges. those are people that I think qualify.
Qualified teachers.
So it's a structural problem. We have a systemic issue.
We have a systemic issue.
How people become teachers. Hmm.
Let's take a quick time out. We need to pay bills. When we come back, the conversation will continue.
Hi guys, my name is Tolulope Adeleru Balogun. I currently host Morning Crossfire. I'm here to tell you that you have to get your PVC. Your permanent voter's card is your power, and in your hand you hold the power to make any necessary change that you want in Nigeria. Please participate, because elections are not the end of democracy and governance. The highest office in the land is the office of the citizen. You and I are citizens of Nigeria.
Nigeria's first 24/7.
Your PVC, all news, your voice.
99.3 Nigeria Edge.
Stay with us as we cover unfolding events around Nigeria, Africa, and the world. All the news, all day, every day, right here on Nigeria Info.
99.3.
Nigeria Info. I am listening.
We know what's happening everywhere and every time. Giving you the latest happenings in Nigeria and around the world. The Breakfast News Digest, 6 a.m. to 10 a.m. every weekday on 99.3. Nigeria Info. Nigeria Info.
And we are continuing the conversation talking about the trend of failures in the West African senior secondary school certificate examination. And it is a worrying issue, but there are some who have said it is the teachers that are to blame. Some have said parents are becoming too lenient and not watching what their kids are doing. Others have said it is the kids who are to blame. And the conversation has also circled around to government's policies and the inadequacies of funding, as well as maybe the need for structural reforms. Now, there is another interesting angle to this. Some have even said it is the double promotion given to pupils that may also be responsible for many children failing English language and mathematics in the West African Senior School Certificate Examination. It was Managing Director and CEO of HEMA International Education, Dr. Yinka Agumbiade, who said that parents seeking double promotion were also the ones who were actually setting their kids up for failure. He said that they were encouraging double promotion for financial reasons, and that they were also using lesson teachers to fill the gap in the future, and that they could also be responsible for some of the failures we're seeing in the WASEC exam. I'll leave that there. You guys will touch that.
I mean, Tony, I have a problem with that. Unfortunately, my son got, a promotion, and I paid nothing. I remembered when the class teacher approached me and was saying that, daddy, I think we should just put him in primary four. This was from primary two. So my son actually jumped primary three.
No, not that you will pay, but that the parents see it as it will start reducing how much I pay the faster you get out.
Oh, yeah. That's a problem.
But we also know that the Senate did summon the education minister in March as well, and that is Malam Adamu Adamu, who appeared before the Senate, Senator Aliyu Wamako-led Committee on Education to explain why Nigeria was experiencing mass failure in the West African School Certificate Examination. Now, he explained, or he was meant to go, but as of the time of this story, he had not gone to those explanations. And many people also wonder what exactly is happening. What is the ministry doing?
It cannot go. It does not have anything.
Alex, let's talk about this. So as far as EduPlanner knows, and I know you guys track these conversations, you track what is being said by major stakeholders and policy policy people in the space. What is the ministry's action plan? What is the ministry saying regarding the failure in the examination so far?
Well, the ministry is yet to respond to the...
As of March,
January, the failure of 80-something percent. But on the whole, it doesn't appear they are going to do much about it because there are systemic issues. It's not just this January. It's not just last May or last January.
Yeah, true.
This thing goes back 2009. So if you are going to... It's not going to be a fire brigade, something that would just... So that this... They are going to start the next phase this May. So whatever has not been done by to solve, to prevent January...
There's an ongoing exam right now.
So the ministry had better get its act together. It will not... it may not prevent a mass failure this May. Let me be a prophet of doom. But it can do something for the future. And like I said, these issues are systemic. We talked about the facilities. Mm-hmm. We've talked about preparation. And when we talked about society, I mean, the head of WAEC in Nigeria here was right. There are some, the children are victims of the society. And let me give you just a picture. When you see a child, a boy, who is supposed to be maybe in SS2, you see him with sheets of paper, and you think maybe they are exam notes.
Maybe not even in class, just on the streets.
You see him with pieces of paper. I think maybe assignments or something. They are betting slips.
We're going to talk about betting one day. You know, you people have my head, but we'll talk about it.
Last year, there was a Premium Times investigation. Betting is supposed to be 18 and above.
Yes.
But you have many, many, many children. 14, 15, 13. Who do these things? And
Premium Times also found that teachers were sending the kids to place bets for them.
For them, of course. So if children at that age are so involved in betting, trying to make economic means, they don't have any business with studying. Because if you hit one and hit 60,000, what all you're planning for is to hit the next one, so it will be 240,000. So you're not much interested in books or whatever. And we have other societal issues, you know, where some children get to do extracurricular activities that are so servile that when you get home,
you can't study.
You probably, the only time you're free is 11 p.m. and you have to sleep and wake up by 5 a.m. for the next day.
I mean, what about the ones that happen in the school vicinity? The teachers sells. They bring groundnuts. They sell pure water. They sell chin chin. They sell plantain chips. So I have been there.
That's where I think the government, the ministry, can come in. So you do these school visitations and you find out how the setting. So what are teachers doing to give students enough time to study? Something I don't know if it's still done, but guidance and counseling is very, very important.
Is that because still done in school?
I had
a guidance and counseling teacher.
It's important because it prevents this failure in WAEC. Guidance and counseling is important for students who change schools,
especially midterm and things
midterm,
like that.
Because, for instance, if you move, I moved from a school in Enugu to Abuja. Maybe we don't talk much about culture shock in Nigeria, but there was a culture shock for me.
Mm.
I had to take time to adapt. I remember my first class and I was stood up to answer a question. I was blank. Not because I
didn't know it, but because something you were new.
I was new and it hit my confidence for a while.
Mm.
So even children who change school, who change programs, maybe in SS1 you feel like you want to be a science student, and by the time you're in SS3 first term, you know you're not good in physics and chemistry and you want to switch to economics. You already have a problem with your physics and chemistry in your work because of that. Mm-hmm. So guidance and counseling in conjunction with the PTA
will make a child or a student know, are you in the art class, the commercial class, exactly, the science class?
So that you don't waste your efforts while you go up. You know, if you're supposed to spend 1 hour a day studying English and math and spend 1 hour in physics, if you find out that you have a hardship in physics, you're going to spend 3 hours in the physics and your English and
math. It will rob you time.
So government needs to play a role in the PTA, in following up the schools, in how they teach, so that teachers don't sell granola, teachers don't send
students. I'm aware, Yomi, that I am very much aware that government actually do the recruitment for teachers. They have a body that actually is responsible for teachers, school
and
teachers.
Certifying.
Exactly. I mean, what's that body doing? How do they get this, you know, have baked teachers into our schools?
One thing you must understand, we cannot deny the impact of politics in education now. You see, you know how political appointments go now. You want to employ a teacher, it's who knows who supports your political party, who voted for you when you were going to office. And this is the basis. And
so you are using a teaching job to compensate?
It's a compensation scheme for politicians. And it's one of those things that happened in Kaduna, for example. You saw persons who have been in the system for a while. Because of the processes they used in getting to that, getting that job, it becomes easy for them to just say, well, if I teach, I teach. If I don't teach, I don't. Well, I served in Borno State, Maiduguri. And during school hours, you see teachers just gather together, gisting. They are just gisting during school hours.
And there's a class.
Students are playing. Students are playing. They are roaming around the school. That's what we have. So you look at, there's a cultural attitude towards our education.
Yeah.
And this is stemming down. It's stemming down gradually. Now, when you look at the failure, the WAEC failure rate, for example, it was moving from 38%. To 20-something%. Now we're having 17%. And what this actually means is this, that students start losing confidence because they don't even understand. For a child that is getting 7 A's, he or she will just try to say, okay, I'm going to give it my best shot. Even though others are cheating around me, this is what I've chosen to do. You know, education, the education sector is just a microscopic aspect of the society itself. We cannot leave education out of the society, neither can we leave society out of education. So you see that there's a relationship between the two. And that's what we are saying here. And we are saying that in WAEC now, our performances are reducing gradually. Gradually. This is denting the confidence of students. And eventually, what does that mean? Do we then say that we don't want to learn anymore? What's the future for education?
But look at it from the fact that Nigeria set up another body, you know, that gives opportunity for students to probably...
For
Nigerian students. That's the NECO. Now, compare WAEC and NECO.
And the performance.
Yes. One thing about NECO, remember when I was writing my WAEC, we dread NECO. We all want to write.
People still dread NECO. My niece says, I don't want to run the institute.
Exactly.
It's very difficult.
Exactly. Now look at it from this angle. Now, when you are writing WAEC, you know there's this kind of free-for-all thing, the free-for-all attitude. Oh, we can always find our ways around it.
Anyhow.
But NECO, you know, if I want to write NECO, I must be prepared to write NECO. So if you are not good, if you're not very intelligent, you don't want to write NECO. Because it's going it's going to mess you up. So it's better you just write your WAEC, you know. But if you know you are good and you actually want to give it a try, you write your NECO. And when you are writing NECO, you are very, very serious about it. Your niece you're talking about now, if he or she is writing NECO,
she doesn't want to write NECO.
If she's going to write NECO eventually, you will see her attitude is going to change during that time. That period she's writing that exams, compare the time she's writing, the period she's writing WAEC and the period she's writing NECO. So it comes back. This is psychology behind all this, and it's that psychology that has been broken now, when it comes to WAEC. That's why WAEC needs to fix a lot, and them creating more, because they felt okay when you fail May June,
you have an opportunity before
November December. If you fail November December, there's still another January February. So that's a wrong attitude towards it, and that's one thing they need to change. They need to find a way to curb the leakages. First thing first, how do they break the examination malpractice syndicate? If you can break that, there's a seriousness on the part of the students.
That there's no other way for them except to do it themselves.
Or that their backs are now against the wall, and you push them to be creative, to be serious, and do things the right way. They even confront their teachers.
Now, but the school system cannot be exonerated from examination malpractice.
Exactly.
The teachers who taught them or who prepared the students for WAEC are also part of the syndicate.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Especially in schools.
Exactly.
In Nigerian schools.
It's you look at, it's all about the money now. It's all about the money. Teacher that is,
or maybe it's the fame for the school, so that the school becomes more popular, that we have 80% success in the last riot.
Let me correct the notion now.
There is a handbook in my son's school that they put it there all the time. The success, you know, the number of people, the percentage of people who pass riot.
It's something to be proud of.
Let me correct the notion. You see,
when they actually made it happen,
the schools that actually allow their students write their work know themselves, and the schools that actually do examination malpractice know themselves.
Yeah.
And I would be surprised if WAEC knows them too.
Yeah. So
WAEC should know that.
There's an unwritten code somewhere that we know how these things work. So that's why when you're trying to maybe you're trying to admit your child into a school now, for example, and you ask around, they will give you the real facts. That's cool. Yes. They will tell you that the best they got 7 A's and 2 B's, but this is how they get it. So you cannot expect a school that is having paying average fees, students pay average fees, to actually perform. So you have to be able to complete your curriculum. You have to pay your teachers very well. They need to have a very, very sound curriculum and deliver very well in the classroom with the right moral attitude. That's when you can get students to be serious and say, this is WAEC. I could remember when I was about to write my WAEC from SS2. It started prepping us down. That you are writing WAEC next year, you need to be serious. We're not going to take this attitude from you. And you could know there was a psychology change over time. And before the WAEC period was on, you know, there were a series of lessons, there was a series of intensive coaching for us. These are what you do, these are what you don't do. Because when you get to the exam hall, you're facing it yourself. But today, there's this leeway attitude on the part of the school, on the part of the teachers, on the part of the students. So when WAEC time comes, everybody has gotten their answer already.
Why don't they move their teachers to another school to invigilate, and then bring all the teachers into?
Yes, that's
why. I mean,
do we really want to change this trend? That's the first question. Do we really want to change?
Somewhere is just not thinking.
I think we are thinking. We are thinkers.
I don't think so.
No, we are thinkers. We just don't have the willpower.
I mean, let's take a school A and a school B, and WAEC wants to checkmate examination malpractice, and you say, you know what, all the teachers in school B will be moved to a particular, maybe 24 hours to
the
start of the...
you have external invigilators.
How many external invigilators come to schools?
No, the external invigilator has that power to say, okay, I'm not comfortable with the conduct of examination in this school, so I'm reporting
that there is heavy malpractice.
But that is already after the exam is taken. If they find that they believe there's no malpractice, that exam has gone. It doesn't stop the exam. It doesn't stop that malpractice possibly happening right then and there. You write after the fact.
Yeah, you write after the fact.
So what are we saying?
Well, you can change it.
But can't you stop examination in that school going for at that time? Not even for that particular subject that is reporting or she's reporting on.
Then you blacklist them for
example. And then you are blacklisted. The WASC exam will not continue in this school this year.
Exactly. Then the onus comes
then
back.
Then the parents
to
will now start saying that you want to attack parents. So it's us poor people that are sending our kids to school that won't work.
Yes.
Sentiments will not allow it to work.
Because
sentiment
parents
is
now
well.
Come here. Yeah,
parents
get you,
will
I get
now
you.
Come and tell you that it's
so my child is not going to write my this year
exactly.
Because of this.
It won't work.
No, it won't work.
And I think that's what we find ourselves, especially when you look at the Kaduna situation. The tough decisions and the tough actions need to be taken. So we have about 8 minutes left, and let's get to that. What are the tough decisions and actions that need to be taken on this situation now? Alex, let me start with you. You talked about the structural issues, and we talked about qualification of teachers. What are the tough decisions we need to make when it
How
comes
does it
to
get better?
To this situation?
Government has to put more money in education. It's
I dislike it, this conversation.
So that's it's fundamental because unfortunately this is how it is. If you have a leaking roof and the students are under it, now the students have a duty, since the roof is leaking, they can't fix it, they have a duty to move their mattresses, right? But when the roof continues leaking, eventually something has to be done about it. Someone has to fix the mm-hmm. leaking roof. You can get a bucket and put there and take the water and keep taking it out. You're going to tire. Someone has to fix that leaking roof.
And most times the only person who can fix it is the owner.
Yeah, and yes. The owner is the government. And the government has to, I mean, we are 6% or 7%. We are the worst in West Africa. You know, we are far from 26%. So there has to be money there for the schools, for the libraries, for the laboratories, for the books, and then for the teachers. Mm-hmm. It's
like in Japan, teachers are the highest paid civil servants in Japan.
Do you see what Japanese children eat for lunch? Japan schools
actually
is like in 2014.
They are treated like engineers.
Teachers' welfare, teachers' training, and teachers' salary. Teachers' welfare, teachers' training, teachers' salary. There needs to be a consistent teachers' training going on. You understand? Maybe they are going on holidays by July, for example. There should be a teachers' training to refine them, to make them better, to deliver better in the classroom. But mind you, most of what we are saying, most of our experiences here in this room right now is about private schools. We don't want to go to the public schools.
Let me take a tweet from Ayodeji. He said, why won't students fail when the teachers have been so relegated to subpar level that teaching is now the last resort for whoever is left unemployed by other professions, whether trained or not? How many high-flying students want to become teachers? And even the ones who become teachers, they don't want to become teachers in Nigeria.
Mm.
Tolu, I was trying to find out from a teacher how they prepare their students for WAEC, and she corrected me that they don't do WAEC in their school, that they do IGCSE. Their children there come there, and SS3 they do IGCSE.
Cambridge.
And they go. So I'm thinking. So
and they go where?
And they go
to the abroad.
Yes, they go to the abroad. So. We have schools in Nigeria
that have completely sidelined
work. So they have nothing to do with Nigeria here. When they're done,
they have affiliates. They have schools that they are affiliated to outside the country,
and they
prepare.
And the implication is that we have more demand for Forex for payment of school fees abroad, because those when they finish secondary school, they continue university there. So we have an effect on our economy which we are not paying attention to. So there are many things. It may seem WAEC failure is not a big deal. It's a big deal. We are having a growing population of unemployable people.
Largest youth population
unemployable
in our history
people.
Ever.
And we are 180 million now. When we get to 250, we're going to have a number of people who cannot add to the development of this country, yet our population will continue to expand.
To grow.
We'll continue to be excluded from the global economy.
By 2050 now, Nigeria is going to be 411 million people.
Third largest, most populous country in the world with this standard of education. Let's take a few messages on WhatsApp. Phil from Maryland. Exam malpractice has eaten deep into our schools. We have special centers who specialize in exam malpractice. They promise 7 A's boldly. When I wrote JAM 4 years ago, a special center brought Nokia Touchlight phones to all their candidates to receive expo. Now they've advanced. Parents even sponsor their kids for this purpose. This one says, you didn't even email, I'll take it because I have a question. Government should go to schools and check schools that are not government approved and deal with them. Any school, whether public or private, should meet government standard. And the reason I'm asking this, the reason I read this one is because what is government standard?
Exactly. What's government standard?
What is the standard of education for state governments? What is the standard of education for the federal government? So if we talk about government approved and government standard, there are lots of schools that are government approved and government standard. But is government standard good enough anymore? Exactly. What is government standard? What should our standard even be?
Exactly. One of those things we are working on now, Edu Planner, for example, we want to start looking at the government education plan itself. What are the different agencies? What are their responsibilities? What are their roles? So we as Nigerians get to know what is actually inside this education system. Because like a black hole, you just can't get enough of it. You are trying to solve basic education. You're looking at tertiary.
Have you tried consulting the Minister of Education?
No, the Minister of Education, I think being a journalist, has been able to manage this whole thing for the past public 3 years. Yeah, he's been able to manage it. I must
successful.
Because the only event I've seen the Minister of Education get invited and he has attended is the Gates visitation to Nigeria last month. That was the only event I've seen him present. Aside from that, you don't see him outside. He gets a lot of invite. He does not attend. You get representatives going to say the federal government is going to do this, the federal government is going that is what we have. And I dread, like, seriously, I saw the Buhari re-election bid yesterday, and I shook my head about what's going to happen to education in the next 8 years. And the danger is that we have the highest number of out-of-school children
in the world.
We are not making education interesting for students. We tire them out, we don't motivate them, and we are still doing this to them even at this time. It's to parents now and to students, it's like we are just milking them dry.
Yeah, but do you think that the proliferation of private schools is the way to go? No. It seems to be working, a little bit more than what government is offering.
Okay, let me say this. WAEC is going to have a better pass rate in May, June. Right? Quote me.
WAEC, this May, June?
This May, June is going to have it.
Why?
Now, why did
because
I say
because attention
that?
Is on them.
Why did I say that? You see, there's this thing about us in Nigeria. We like to manage perspectives. We like to manage everything that happens around us. We don't tell ourselves
the truth.
And that is a sad thing. The private schools are not doing much. They are far from it.
But this seems to be better than the public schools. Alex.
The only hope. And this same thing you're saying, you know, now we are not having private universities. They are increasing by the day.
And government wants to compete and is asking for more federal universities to do what?
What the danger is this for us? I think very soon people will not be interested in education anymore because they'll be tired of the whole system from basic education.
Federal government schools are bad. The private schools are too expensive to attend.
Exactly.
So at the end of the day, the poor man.
Well, you have a situation now where you have universities and educational institutions like MIT putting free courses online.
MOOCs are the future, but I still don't think it replaces it.
Yes.
It does not. You cannot take that fact that a child wakes up in the morning, he goes to the class, he goes to
the
school,
and
he's serious, he's seated in a place, he goes through 5 classes,
you understand.
Time comes back. You cannot take that away. MOOCs are not.
Thank God I'm school though. I added a lot, I think it worked for me.
One thing we are waiting on is the state of emergency that the government intends to declare. We're supposed to be seeing documents by now of what they've actually assessed, because there's supposed to be a research. Then we look at what they've done, what they plan to do in terms of policies, in terms of funding. Maybe we see better. The APC promised 4.2 trillion during their campaign. Now, so far, in 3 years now, with the 2018 proposed allocation, they're just doing 1.9. So,
we can do that. We can double that in no time.
And this is why we have to pause, because remember, I did promise it's a two-part conversation, and next week we'll get into the funding issue. But this morning we had to focus on the failure trend that we find in the West African Senior Secondary School Certificate Examination. It is a trend that is worrisome, and I'm going to end with something Zeal said this morning. Our education system is responsible for everything. If we have substandard students, we have substandard teachers, and we come out with substandard graduates, we will end up with a substandard society. It is not rocket science. It is simply 1 + 1 equals 2, we will have substandard doctors and teachers and lawyers and professionals and police officers and to some extent substandard politicians as well. Quote me on that. All right, Yomi and Alex, thank you so much. You can follow EduPlanner on Twitter at EduPlanner_NG. They release a number of infographics and break down the whole context behind the money issues and, of course, some of the situations. I know you guys are following the Ondo situation right now, as well as the UI College of Medicine situation. And so you can follow them and get updates on that. But they'll be back next week as we look at funding Nigeria's education system and much more. It's time now for Headline News, and right after that is the Money, Business and Economy Show.
Headline News on 99.3.